Good. Everybody doing good? Having a good day? How many got up this morning and smelt the rain outside? Ooh, was that not good?
No.
Well, you had a skunk smell. The rest of us had rain smell. You can ask him that story later. Man, it is good to have each and every one of you here today. Got a great expectation that God is going to show up in an incredible way and do something just great in our lives. And as we get started, I go ahead and turn to Judges chapter 14. Lynn and Tricia Bauer, happy 31st anniversary! Amen! Go ahead, reach over and give her a little kiss. It's okay to do that in church. You did it when you got married. You can do it today. You're on Kiss Cam. All the kids just went, hey, happy anniversary. It was so good to have you here today. And we know you could have been celebrating, and you came to celebrate with us in Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I'm excited about this series. This series has been fun. Last week, I didn't realize, was last week harsh? No, a little bit. I had a lot of people say that last week was a little hard, and sure didn't mean for it to be hard in any way, form, or fashion, just preaching the Word of God. But I had one lady say that she was going out of town on vacation, and she was glad that she didn't have steel-toed sandals, and she couldn't handle the rest of this series if it was going to be like this. So I don't know what today's going to be, but we'll find out. How's that? So, hey, before we get started, I want to go to the Lord in prayer this morning and just pray. Your pastor decided to do something really ignorant, and he did a red-eye run to the Bloom Fiesta in Albuquerque, and I am way too old for that. Drove all night long and got home last night, and I don't even remember laying my head down on the pillow at 7 last night. That was a hard day. So we're going to pray that the Holy Spirit's with us. How's that sound? And while we're praying, Travis was just telling me that a lady that you work with, correct, had a heart attack, and she took her in, and she literally lost her on the table, revived her, went in and put in a stent or some other stuff. But God knows who she is. God knows where she's at. And I want y'all to agree in prayer this morning that God will touch her, bring healing to her body. But we're going to pray that not just that, that this will be a testimony of how awesome our God is. I know that Nora's looking for work. And God's got the right job, the right finances, the right everything. And if you're here today and you just need a touch of God in your life, guess what? The healer's in the house.
Amen.
The deliverer's here. We don't have to go through situations and just survive. We can, in the power of God, we can thrive and do what He's called us to do and be well and in our right mind in the process of it. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We praise you. And Father, we thank you that you're a God that cares about all of our needs, the big things, the little things, and the things that we think are indifferent. You care about. Because you looked at us, and the Word of God says that we literally are the apple of your eye, and you want the best for us. So today we're going to reach out. We're going to reach out in faith that you will touch us, that you'll minister to us, that you'll give us the right jobs, that the healing will come, that mentally, physically, spiritually, socially, economically, whatever it may be, that you touch us and that you set us free, that the power of God literally is unleashed in each and every one of us. Father, today I pray that you'll just touch me, that you'll take me with my tiredness and everything else that's in me, and you'll anoint the Word of God that is going to be spoken in this place, and that we will leave changed by the power of God. As everybody says,
amen,
amen, amen, amen. Well, the Jalalis are in the house with us today. Mr. and Mrs. Tana and Kevin Jalali. That just sounds weird coming out of my mouth. But stand up. Get a good look at the newlyweds. Come on, sit. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Look back at Lynn and Tricia Bauer and say, that's what I'm going to be 31 years down the road. I'll be so great. Say, you're trendsetters. That's what you are. So God's good, isn't he? Hey, right before we got into the Word of God, I was just going to tell you this morning, man, I was tired when I got to church. So I thought, I'm going to run down here and get me a couple of taquitos at Whataburger. And went down there and got me a couple. And I'm getting me a drink. As I'm getting me something to drink, I hear a lady back in the kitchen. And she's talking about her work schedule. And she says, today I just need to be in church because I need me some Jesus. So I got my drink and I went over and sat down. And I reached into my billfold. And I pulled out a card that says, we've saved a seat for you. And later when I got ready to leave, I walked back to the counter and I said, who's the lady back here that said she needs Jesus? Is that you? Yes. And I said, I'm not eavesdropping. I said, I was standing here getting a drink when you said you need a little bit of Jesus. And I said, I'd love to introduce myself to you. Told her who I was, where I pastored. And I said, I'd love to invite you to come get a little bit of Jesus. And I said, here's a card. Well, you know, we've got a seat saved with your name on it. We would love to you come be a part of what we're doing. And I said, anytime we can help you find Jesus, you are more than welcome in this place. Her name's Lucy, so pray for her, okay? And so anyway, we've got some brand new cards made up. They're a little better than these. They're thicker so people can really hang on to them. I believe they're in the back. Make sure you pick up a card and invite someone to come to church, and we'll just pray that God changes their lives. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to be looking at Judges chapter 14 today. It's where we're going to start. And we're looking through this four-week series at a man by the name of Samson. And if you missed last week, I'm going to give you a real quick rundown, and then we'll kind of dive into today. And as you look at this real quick rundown, Samson was a guy that from his birth, he was set apart, and he was called, chosen, to help bring Israel's deliverance about. He was going to be kind of like one of the forerunners that was helping to get them out of the trouble that they constantly stay in their sin and their disobedience with God. So God is raising up a guy named Samson, and he's going to help deliver them from the oppressive hands of the Philistines that are on them. Now, as we talked last week, there was a Nazarite vow that was on his life from the very beginning. And this vow that was on his life, his family were to really live this way. He was to live this way. This was what was going to set him apart as really a spokesperson for God. And the vow was this. God said, don't touch anything dead. Don't drink any alcohol, and do not cut your hair. So this was the vow that he was to live by. And God gave this man a supernatural strength. Inside Samson, we talked about this. Inside Samson was great potential. Inside each and every one of us that's in this place today, there is great God-given potential inside each one of us to do some incredible things. But even though there was great potential from God, he continued to make self-destructive decisions again and again and again. Does anybody, or are you brave enough to raise your hand, does anybody identify with Samson in any way, form, or fashion? Great God-given potential, but we screw it up over and over and over again because of bad decisions that we make. So last week, we summarized his life up in one sentence, and I want to tell you what it was. Samson was an incredibly strong man with a dangerously weak will. Sounds like a lot of us, don't it? We got so much God-given potential, but we give it up over and 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 over again. We just do it. It's what we do. So last week I gave you three attitudes. Real quick, here they are. The three attitudes were lust, entitlement, and pride. I think this is where the whole congregation went. This is the part that hurt everybody. If you look at it, Samson had this attitude. He fell in lust. You notice I didn't say love with a woman. He fell in lust with a woman. He crossed over the line into enemy's territories. He only went 4 miles into enemy territory to pursue this woman who was hands off to him. He was not supposed to be having anything to do with those that didn't believe in God. He crossed over, and his lust made him say, I want it. I want it. That's what lust does. But then he got a spirit of entitlement. And in the spirit of entitlement, he broke his vow. And it's too much to really get into. Remember, he killed the lion. Later, when he was going back to get his wife, there was a swarm of bees and honey inside the lion's carcass. And the Word of God says he turned aside and he saw it. He wanted it. It's where the lust factor turned in. I call it something sweet that he wanted. He reached inside of the lion's carcass. He touched something dead. It was what he was not supposed to do. He touched something dead in his entitlement because he thought he was so strong, that he was so special. You know what I said about entitlement last week? Your entitlement issues kind of makes us sick. Yeah. But anyway, we won't get into all that. But his entitlement said, I deserve it. So there was lust that said, I want it. There was entitlement that said, I deserve it. And then there was a pride that kicked in. And the pride said, I can handle it. There's so many times that people try to help us. God tries to help us. The Word of God speaks into life and tries to help us. And we look at it and think, oh, I'm stronger than any temptation. I'll just pause and let that one kind of soak in for a minute. I'm stronger than any temptation. I'm stronger than any thought, than anything. I don't need to listen to you. I can do this on my own. And his entitlement said, I can handle it. And it was that beginning of that downward spiral in his life that led him into some big problems that we're looking at. Well, last week I gave you all of that. This week I want to give you another, a couple more of his vulnerabilities that we're going to look at. And if you're taking notes, you might want to write this one down, because this is how we're going to sum up his thoughts and his lives in today's sermon. Like so many of us, Samson was emotionally driven, not spirit-led. You might want to write that down.
Wow.
He was emotionally driven, but not spirit-led. Well, why don't you just repeat it with me, okay? Samson was emotionally driven, not spirit-led. Isn't that where we are in our lives with so many Christians, so many followers of Christ, that we find ourselves falling into problems because we seem to be, that flesh, more physically led than spiritually led. And when we find ourselves not being spiritually led, we find ourselves in trouble. See, the challenge is for all of us, men and women, is that we're truly emotionally led. Now, the men are all looking at their wives going, well, I'm not emotional. You're emotional. All the men said? But how many of you wives know your husbands?
Yeah.
I think that was an amen. But you know your husbands, and even though they have an outward macho man mentality, you know their innermost darkest secrets, and you know that they're emotionally led by some of the things that they do. So to break it down, no matter if you're a man or a woman, how do you handle it? You are emotionally driven by things in your life that happens to us. Amen? So there's a process that we have to walk through to eliminate these emotions that we're not emotionally led. Now, talking about emotions, how do women handle their emotions generally? A woman will be emotionally stressed out, and she will say what? Let's talk about it. Let's talk through it. Which I say, I'm going to go mow the lawn. I don't want to talk about it. Amen? Women like to talk it through. Sit down, discuss it. I'm going to fix it. I'm just going to take care of it. We're going to walk our way through it. But men are not really like that, are we? Men are not so much emotionally driven that we don't want to sit down and talk about it. Us men want to either try to ignore it or just fix it and move on.
Real talk.
Isn't that kind of how we handle it emotionally? There was years back, my wife was working on her master's. And she was at the table and had been working for about 2 straight hours on, I think it was a test or something, some homework that she had to submit. And she'd been working 2 hours straight on this. She was pretty much bumfuzzled and fried. 4 hours. Oh, it was 4 hours. Sorry. My notes sounded better than the reality. But it was 4 hours. But she had been there, sitting there working on this. And she was emotionally, mentally stressed and fried. And when she went to hit the send button or whatever, it zapped and she lost everything that she had worked on for 4 hours.
Oh, heck no.
Her emotions scared me. They were everywhere. I wasn't emotionally driven up until that moment. But at that moment, I wanted to fix everything. And there was something, Tori's a little bit different, but there's something about my wife, and especially Tana, just in case you're ever dealing with them, that they don't like questions. Don't ask them questions. Because if they're stressed out, they're not going to answer your questions. They will look at you with stressful, emotional eyeballs. And I was asking Shannon all the stress questions. Did you do this? Did you back it up here? Did you? And the more I asked the questions, the more emotional she became. I saw a cry come out of her that I'd never seen before. The ones that are laughing have been there. I just know you. I didn't know what to do. I couldn't fix her problem, but I cleaned the kitchen. I couldn't fix her problem, but I got her something to drink and something to nibble on. Couldn't fix her problem, but I went in and cleaned the rest of the house. I cleaned the bathrooms. I scrubbed the toilets. I made the bed. I took the dogs out and I groomed them and whatnot. But I saw her being emotionally stressed out, and I was trying to do anything and everything I could to fix that. Isn't it amazing how our emotions will drive us to do certain things? So many times problems arise and our emotions get in the way. And we find that when our emotions get in the way, correct me if I'm wrong, we have a tendency to do ungodly things. That was just funny to me. Instead of spirit-led things. Anybody with me on that?
Amen.
And we don't do what's right. We do what's stupid because our emotions take over, and then we back and go, well, I didn't mean to punch the wall. You know what our emotions do? I didn't mean to cuss that person out. I didn't mean to let the bird out of the cage and let him fly when they cut me off in traffic. I didn't mean to belittle them or to cut them down. I just got so mad. I lost control and I let my emotions lead me into a place I really had no intention in going. Because I allowed myself to be emotionally led instead of spirit-led. You remember what the Bible says? The Bible tells us to be angry. Somebody go, amen, I like that scripture. But we got to take it a little further. The Bible says to be angry and to sin not. It's okay to have a righteous anger. It's okay to even be upset. But don't it lead you into a place where your emotions kick in and your emotions take control and you're no longer spirit-led, but you're emotionally driven. I don't know how this plays out in a lot of your homes where your emotions kick in. Maybe you're that person that you work hard at work. I mean, you work hard, long days, long hours. And you want more than anything when that day's over with to come home and engage with your wife and engage with your kids because you want to have that relationship with them. But you get home and you're so emotionally spent, so emotionally bent, you've worked so hard that you're so tired that you let the tired emotions kick in, and instead of spending any quality time at all with your wife or your kids, you spend it with a remote and a recliner. Emotionally driven. You may be at a place in your life where you've done something really dumb, and then you open your mouth and something really stupid comes out, and you know that you should apologize, but you don't because of pride. You can't let yourself go to that place because of pride, and instead of being spirit-led to just apologize, you find yourself emotionally because of pride. That hurts, doesn't it? Then there's all of us. And we don't want to explode in anger. How many's got an easy button? That was easy. You got an easy button? You don't mean to explode in anger, but just let somebody push that button at the right time, at the wrong place. That was easy. And we just explode because we're emotionally driven instead of spirit-led. And remember what Paul said to us in Romans 7:15? He said this, why is it that the things I want to do, I don't do? Here's the Apostle Paul who wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. the greatest church planter and evangelist the world has ever seen, and he struggles with the exact same issues you and I do. Why is it that the things I want to do, I don't do, and the things I don't want to do, I end up doing? For so many of us, because we're mostly driven to the spirit level. But let's follow up what he says in Galatians 5, 16 and 17. That's what he says. If that's you and you find yourself in this place, he says this, walk by the Spirit. Something that we have to do. We have to be Spirit-led in our lives to get beyond the things that cause us to do dumb things. Walk by the Spirit. And if you do this, you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. The flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict. It means there's a fight going on within you of Spirit and flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so you are not to do whatever you want. That's good, isn't it? That's God saying, don't do what you want to do because you can't trust you. Well, let's see how this plays out in Samson's life. Missed last week, let me catch up real quick. He's pursuing a woman who worships false gods. She's a Philistine woman. The Philistines are the enemies of God's people. Samson is being raised up as a prophet and a judge to judge the people and to lead them out of bondage of the Philistines. It's one of the things that he's doing. And to lead them into godliness. He's the beginning of what God really wants to do in their life. But he sees this Philistine woman and he says, what? I lust after her. I want her. I'm strong. I deserve her. Even though I'm not supposed to handle it, I'm so strong my pride's going to get in the way. But I think I can handle it. I don't care what God says. I don't care what the Word of God says. I don't even care what my covenant says. I want her. I want her. And he wanted her and it got him in trouble. He said, I want to marry her. That's how much he wanted her, lusting after her. I want to marry her, and I don't care what God says, and I don't care what my mom and daddy say. I want to marry her. He throws himself a bachelor party, basically, tap the keg at the party, and the Word of God says, because of his vow that he had with God, he was not to drink any alcohol. Matter of fact, his vow was so strict that he couldn't even be around grape juice, and he couldn't even let a grape touch his lips, and he couldn't be around a vineyard. That's how serious God was about his law. Where did he kill the lion? At a vineyard. He was so cocky and arrogant and emotionally driven that he wasn't paying any attention to God. So now he's at the keg party. He's at the wedding. He's doing all kinds of things that he's not supposed to be doing. He's in a downward spiral of a cycle of things going south in his life. He's not listening to God. He's not listening to his parents. He's not listening to his friends. He's not listening to anybody. And now he's trying to marry this Philistine woman. And he's hanging around, probably having a keg party with about 30 Philistine men who are his enemy. They're the ones that's been taking God's people down the wrong road. They're the ones that have kept God's people captive for so many years. They're the ones that he is supposed to be leading them away from. And now he finds himself sitting at a keg party with them. And they're drinking. They're having a party. And he does something really dumb. Anybody ever done anything dumb? I started to say, has anybody ever done anything dumb at a keg party? But I'm not going to go there. Has anybody ever done anything dumb? He's sitting there talking with these 30 men, and his pride gets involved, and he looks at them, and he says, hey, I'm going to tell you a little riddle. He goes, let's have a battle of wits, because everybody knows that men love competitions, don't we? Yep. Well, I'll bet the Cowboys are going to win today. Cowboys aren't going to win today. I bet you a dollar they are. Isn't that how we operate? We're always going to bet. We're going to put a little wager on it. So he says, okay, let's put a little wager on it. Because everybody knows that we love competition. He says this, I'll bet you 30 pieces of linen and 30 pieces of clothing that you can't win, and I bet that you'll lose. So I want to show you this riddle real quick. Well, the riddle was that he told me, I'm going to give you 30 days to figure this thing out. And if you can't figure it out, you owe me 30 pieces of linen. But if you figure it out, all right, I'm going to give you 30 pieces. It's just a little bet, a little wager. By the way, don't you know how stupid that was for Samson? Because if he loses, he's got to come up with 30 outfits. If the 30 men lose, they just got to come up with one. I mean, showing how dumb he is to begin with. His arrogance has really gotten the best of him. So he says, I'm going to give you 7 days to figure this out. Now, here's the riddle. Remember last week, he killed a lion. There was a dead carcass that he wasn't supposed to touch, but inside the carcass there was honey. There was bees and honey inside the carcass. Everybody remember that? And he wasn't supposed to touch it, but he did. He scoops out the honey. So he compromised his vows before God. All that plays in what he's doing. So here it is, verse 14, chapter 14, verse 14, and this is what he says to him. Out of the eater, something to eat. Out of the strong, something sweet. And the Word of God says, for 3 days, they could not come up with an answer. They could find it. They could not give the answer. What was he talking about? Well, he was talking about the dead lion, and he was talking about the honey. The strong and the eater, and the eat and the sweet, the lion and its honey, is what he was talking about. And before 3 days was up, the Philistine men had gotten so agitated that they couldn't come up with the answer. So the Philistine guys, they get angry and they lose it. The Philistines, the ungodly people, are emotionally driven. They lose it. And they go to the woman who is about to marry Samson. And they go to her and they say, this is what we want you to do, woman. Trick him. We want you to trick him. Get the secret out of him. And we are so serious about that. If you don't get the secret out of him and bring the secret back to us, we're going to burn you to death. We've all seen the witch hunts where they took the witches and tied them to a post and lit them on fire where they were still alive. Basically, what they were going to do, it says, we're going to burn you to death, but we're not even going to stop there. We're going to go get your daddy, and we're going to put him with you, and we're going to burn you and your dad to death. So the bride of Samson uses her greatest weapon as a woman that she has. When in doubt, ladies, cry. Cry. It will work almost every time on a man. When in doubt, cry. And for 7 days... She whined for 7 days. She cried for 7 days. She nagged at him. Samson, you don't love me. Nope. Samson, you don't want me around. If you really love me, you tell me the secret. And she cried. Finally, he caves in. He tells her the secret. And that's where we're going to pick up the rest of the story. In verse 18, it says this. Before sunset on the seventh day, the men of the town said to Samson, we have the answer. What is sweeter than honey and what is stronger than a lion? Samson just blew his top. He was so cocky, so arrogant, he didn't think anybody would know. He blows his top. He is furious that they figured out the riddle. He is furious that the strongest man in the entire world lost to 30 mere mortal, ordinary men. He cannot believe it. He is embarrassed. He's angry. He's ashamed of himself. And he says the dumbest thing, the stupidest thing that anyone could ever say. Has anybody in your anger ever said anything stupid and did you go, oh, that's embarrassing. Mm-hmm. Pee Wee Herman, I meant to do that. Remember? Fall off his bike, I meant to do that. Shut up! Shut, don't go up. I mean, isn't it funny how we can just say the dumbest things? He looked at these men and check this out. This is what he says to them. Oh, he's so mad! He's so mad! And this is what he says. Well, if you hadn't tied up my heifer, you wouldn't solve the riddle. Riddle. Sorry, babe. If you hadn't played with my heifer, you wouldn't have solved the riddle. Really? Oh, Samson, you're strong, but you're missing a train upstairs. You know, your boots came off. It kind of makes you laugh just a little bit, doesn't it? You hadn't plowed with my heifer. I don't know, I could go a lot of places with that. Probably should just move on, shouldn't I? I don't know, that's just funny. I hadn't plowed with my heifer. He wouldn't have got the riddle. So we watch how Samson, he caves into this weakness of these men, and he finds himself being emotionally driven instead of being spirit-led, and he acts out with his emotions. Remember, what is it? He is an emotionally driven man and not spirit-led. He falls victim into two emotions that we're going to look at today, just real quick. Two emotions that often take, this is the title of the series, the sermon today. He falls emotions to two things that take strong men and strong women down. Maybe you can relate to this. The first one is this. He falls victim to the emotion of anger. Anger. I tell you, Samson is an incredible story when you really dive into it, tear it apart, and begin to look at it. It's just interesting to me. Judges chapter 14, verse 19, it says this. This is what happens in the middle of his anger. And this is what happens in the middle of him starting to do something stupid. It says, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon him. When did the Spirit of the Lord come upon him? When? Anybody else got a thought? When did the Spirit of the Lord come upon Samson? When he said something, done? You're all right. Dumb. Am I talking about dumb? I'm having one of those problems today. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him when he was beginning to act something out. Catch a hold of this. How often do we act something out in our lives? Good or bad? Spirit of the Lord is there to protect him, to guide him, to lead him, to make him do incredibly powerful things. Spirit of the Lord is there at the beginning of his actions. Some of us need to hear this. But he took his God-given potential, he took his anointing of something powerful that came upon him, and he did something incredibly dumb with it. So I've heard people ask all the time, well, how was Samson able to do so many incredible things when he was still so stupid? Well, thank God that he doesn't view us because we're stupid, because we all are. And if that was the only indication of how God's going to give us power, he wouldn't give it to any of us. You know what I mean? It's there at the beginning of our actions. So what are you going to do? Are you going to be fleshly led, or are we going to be spirit led? Are we going to be emotionally led, or are we going to be spirit driven in what we're doing? Spirit of God was there for him to make a decision. What does he do? We see very quick that he makes the wrong decision. He does the wrong thing with the power of God still upon him. That's how our God operates. Our God is there to say, you may be going to do something dumb, but I'm going to give you my power. I'm going to give you my presence. I'm going to give you what you need to get yourself out of this mess. Let's see how you operate. Are you going to follow my lead, or are you going to fall into your flesh? He went down to Ashkenaz, how do you say that? And he struck down about 30 men. This is what he does with his anger. This is what he does with his emotions. He gets so bent out of control that the power and the presence of God is over him, but he can't get beyond his emotions, so he does something stupid. He goes down and he strikes down 30 men. He strips them of everything, and he gives their clothes to those who explain the riddle. And burning with anger, he returns to his father's house. What did he do? He killed 30 innocent men Because he was emotionally driven. But how many times do we kill people that we're so close to because we can't get our attitude right? We cannot get our addictions under control. We can't control our mouth. We can't control the things that fly out of us. And we do all kinds of things, and we kill those that we love physically, emotionally, socially, and mentally, that's all around us. And we look at Samson, how can you be so stupid? When sometimes we look at ourselves and say, I am that stupid. So he kills 30 men, innocent men, and he strips them of all of their clothes. Oh, he's mad. He is burning with anger. He takes all those clothes back. I don't think I'd want them after somebody died in them. But he was being honorable to his bet, wasn't he? He takes all these 30 pieces of clothing, and he goes and gives them to the 30 guys that win the bet. And he's so mad and burning with anger, he doesn't even honor the woman he's engaged to be married to, that they've already gone through the wedding ceremony part of it, of having all the festival feasts that's going along with it. And he's so burning hot, he can't even go back to marry her. Instead, he goes back to his daddy's house to blow off some steam. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? I think it's just interesting. Look at Judges 14:20, what happened in his absence. And Samson's wife was given to one of his companions who attended him at the feast. Is that funny to anybody but me? It's just an odd story, isn't it? He goes away, he doesn't show up, and the dad's sitting there, and he's going, okay, we've got a party, I've got the wife, we've got the invitations out, she's in the dress, everything's done, except where is the groom? Where's he at? He's not here. He's not, we're going to have a party anyway. You're going to marry my daughter. Okay. And they have a wedding. It's interesting, isn't it? Samson shows up later. We don't know how much time later. I mean, how much time does it take to kill 30 men? How long does it take to strip them naked? How long does it take to go give their clothes to 30 other men and confront them? How much time does it take to be angry and to go back home and to blow off some steam? So we don't know how much time passed. But sometime later, he comes back. Samson is a hothead that is emotionally driven. He's done things. He shows up and he walks in. And somebody says, oh, by the way, she's not your wife anymore. Daddy gave her to her. Him. She married to him. What do you think Samson did in his anger? He's not being spirit-led. Word of God says that he went out and began to roam the hillside, and he tracks down and he finds 300 foxes. Weird story. It just gets weirder. He has 300 foxes. I'm trying to picture all this as I'm writing this sermon. Where in the world has he put 300 foxes? How do you do that? How do you catch 300? He has 300 foxes. He picks them up in pairs and he ties their tails together. Ouch, it's right. So now he's got 150 pair of foxes. He's angry. And he goes and he gets a torch. He ties it to the tail of the pair of foxes. And each one of them, he lights the torch on fire. And he sets the two foxes that are tied together with the flame between their hotties. He turns them loose on all the Philistines' land. And as they're running crazy, can you imagine this? As they're running crazy and out of control with fire between their hinds, these foxes run throughout the entire Philistine area. It's catching their crops on fire. It's burning all their feed, all everything. It's burning some of their villages, their houses. He has committed so much havoc out of his anger. And the Philistines look at this. They know Samson did it. They are so mad, they don't know what to do. So guess what the Philistines do? Well, we'll get back at you, Samson. That woman who was going to be your wife, we're just going to go burn her and her dad to death. We'll show you. And they burn them up. Wow. His anger may have seemed small to begin with, but now we're seeing mashed casualties because he couldn't control his emotions because he stopped being spirit-led. Wow, isn't that tough? So we're seeing how his emotions are costing him big time. See, here's the challenge for all of us today. The challenge is, for many of us, is our anger. We find that our anger is our negative default emotion. Wow. How true is that? We find that it is our negative default emotion. Somebody embarrasses you. And instead of just being embarrassed, we let our embarrassment be act out in anger. And we say things like, I'll show them, they'll never make me feel that way ever again. And then we end up doing something stupid, emotionally driven. And we all act out in different ways, don't we? A woman gets up in the middle of the night, she stumps her toe on the chair in the middle of the room. Now, something may come out of her mouth, but she's going to sit down and nurse that toe, because that's what women do. They nurse things. They nurture things. They take care of them. But let a man walk in instead of his toe on that same chair. We're going to be patching the wall the next day, because we're going to kick that chair across the room. Stupid chair! And we let our emotions act out, because we have a tendency that when anger arises, we go to our negative default emotion. So I said this earlier, so someone cuts us off in traffic. What's your default emotion? Someone tells you something that you really don't like. What is your default emotion? Someone's rude to you at the store. I was just asking a question. What is your negative default emotion? Someone says something that you don't like. Someone tells you to do something. And how many of us do not like to be told what to do by anybody at any time? What is our negative default emotion? Someone cuts you down, belittles you, embarrasses you, whatever it may be. But think about this. What did Samson have to be angry about? What was it that made him so mad? Let's look at what made him so mad. Okay, you ready? He and he alone went to pursue the wrong woman. Nobody made him do that. He was the one who decided he wanted to marry her. He was the one who ignored his parents' advice, and he is the one who ignored God's rules. He is the one who taunted the Philistines with the riddle. He is the only one who knew the secret until he gave it away. He's the one who left his wife at the altar. He's the one who went and killed 30 innocent men just to strip their clothes off of them. He's the one who burned all the villages, burned all the crops with the 300 foxes. And he's mad at the world when in reality he should be mad at himself. And that's how we all operate. That's how we operate. And that's where so many of us end up living, is we're angry at the world when we, in reality we should be angry at ourselves. But I think we all find ourselves in this place, don't we? Every day we get up and we find ourselves in the place that we find ourselves being emotionally driven. I hate my stupid job. And our emotions get out of control. I hate my stupid boss. And we let our emotions get out of control. I hate my stupid pastor. And we let our emotions get out of control. We may be mad because we look at ourselves at a place now that we're going, oh, I had every opportunity to go to college and get a degree, and I didn't do anything with my life that I wanted to do because I was too busy being emotionally driven. We may be mad at someone because, or ourselves or someone, because we took a job, and the whole time we've taken it, we feel like it is beneath us, and we just find ourselves angry. Why do I have to do this job? Why am I doing this? A lot of times we find ourselves angry and taking it out on other people when we should be taking it out on ourselves. We come home and we know that our wife or our husband, we know that they have needs that emotionally should be met, and we're not meeting them. We find that there's anger being built on both sides of that. Could be that we're at a place and we shake our fist at God and say, but God, why did you allow this to happen to me? God, why did you do this? A lot of times God's looking back down going, you can shake your fist all you want to. All the power and potential in the world is inside of you to do whatever you want to do. And you've screwed up every decision I've ever given you because you've been emotionally driven instead of spirit driven. We shake our fist at God and we're so mad at God, and God is saying, everything you need is inside you. All you need to do is cry out to me. All you need to do is obey the rules I give to you. The power is there. The promise is there. It's the process that you're getting lost in because you're emotionally driven instead of being spiritually led. Isn't that good?
Yes.
We blame it on everybody when we should be blaming ourselves. Second one is this. He's burning with anger. And the second one is this. We find that he is now filled with pride. So now he's burned up everybody's land. They go and they get his supposed to be wife, and they burn her and kill her, burn her alive and kill her. Not only that, they take her dad, they burn him alive and they kill him. He is now so emotionally driven, and every one of the mistakes are his. He's done everything wrong, and he's blaming everybody. He's emotionally driven. He is so messed up. What does he do now? Pride kicks in, and look at Judges 15:15. Finding a fresh jawbone of a donkey, he grabs it and he strikes down now 1,000 men in his anger. Wow, isn't that amazing? That's cocky. That's like UFC on steroids. Plus 1,000 times plus the power of God on top of that. I mean, that's just crazy. He takes a jawbone of a donkey and he kills 1,000 men. And what does Samson say? Look at verse 16. And then Samson said, with a donkey's jawbone, I have made donkeys out of them. That's just the Bible being nice. It's really a crooked letter, crooked letter. That's what he's saying. With a jawbone of a donkey. Samson said, with a donkey's jawbone, I have made donkeys of them, and with a donkey's jawbone, I have killed 1,000 men. Isn't it amazing where pride and anger will take us when we are not being spiritually led? Do you think he woke up one morning and thought, hey, here in a week or two, or whatever the time frame is, these are all the wrongs I'm going to do. I'm going to be a screwed up mess at the very end of this. Do you think he woke up one day and planned to do this? No. He woke up one day and ignored God. He woke up one day, ignored advice. He woke up one day, ignored his promise to God. He woke up one day and ignored his anointing. He does his own thing, Anger has cost him and cost him and cost him and cost him and has cost the lives of a lot of innocent people. And now he's mad at the world. And we would really just, we would call him a smart aleck. What are you, smart aleck? You let your emotions get the best of us. It happens a lot, doesn't it? And we look at it and we say, you're just a man that is full of pride. What does pride say? Pride says, look at me. Pride says, I'm strong. Pride says, I can handle this. Pride says, I'm so impressed with myself. That's what pride says. Pride says, I can conquer this on my own strength. I can do this. Pride says, I am great. Do you know what pride is? Come on, I'm going to write this down. Pride is almost always born out of insecurities.
Wow.
You feel insecurity? Be very careful. When you don't know who you are in Christ, pride is the first emotion that will rise up and take us down. Somebody may want to Facebook that because that's a good one. How about if I just repeat that for you? When we don't know who we are in Christ, pride is the first emotion that will rise up and take us down. Look at James chapter 4 real quick. James chapter 4, verse 6. But he gives us more grace, and that's why the scripture says God opposes the proud and he shows favor to the humble. Remember that one, okay? He shows favor to the humble. Opposes the proud, shows favor to the humble. Look at Proverbs 16:18. Proverbs 16:18, and I'm reading it from the God's Word translation, says this: pride precedes a disaster. Did we just point out a whole disaster that Samson just went through? And why? Because of his pride. Because of his pride and because of his anger. Pride precedes a disaster, and an arrogant attitude precedes a fall. Well, that's good, isn't it? But what's the flip side? What's the flip side? Let's go back to what the Apostle Paul said. Live by the Spirit, and if you live by the Spirit, you will not gratify the desires of the fleshly nature. For allowing ourselves to be Spirit-led, we will not gratify the desires of the fleshly nature. Because the fleshly nature is what? It is in a constant conflict with the Spirit. And the Spirit is in conflict with the fleshly nature, so you don't do what you want to do. In other words, don't act out in anger. Don't explode at people. Let me lean back up and say it in a better way. Instead of letting the enemy have a heyday on our emotions that destroys our testimony and our influence, be led by the Spirit so that we can introduce people to God through our actions.
That's good.
Is it easier to flip someone off in traffic or to point at your bumper sticker and say, follow me to family worship center? By the way, if you're flipping people off, don't put a bumper sticker on your car. Please. We find ourselves so many times being emotionally driven. And here was a man who had so much God-given potential. Can I tell something about each and every one of us in this place? You have so much God-given potential. When God created you, He created you with a purpose, with a plan, and for a reason. And it's the enemy who comes to do what? Kill, steal, and to destroy. And we need to find ourselves backing up, coming to a place, pausing and thinking. Can I say something too about most everybody in this congregation?
Sure.
The first things you want to say out of your mouth will probably be the wrong things. Probably. It may come from a heart of a right spirit, but somewhere what we know is right and what we say gets all screwed up and it comes out wrong and it comes out bitter and it comes out harsh and it comes out being a bad testimony. If you find yourself in a place of anger, Word of God says the Spirit of God was upon Samson. Can I tell you something? The Word of God says greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That same power that raised Christ Jesus from the dead is the same power that's upon Samson, is the same power that dwells in each and every one of us as children of God. When you are in a situation where you are being emotionally driven, if you're in a situation where they are pushing your "that was easy" button, if you're in a place where you find yourself wanting to cave into pressure, peer pressure, if you find yourself in a place where you're going to do something you know you should not do, men, when you're doing stuff over here and your wife would not approve of it and you're feeling like you have to hide it, don't do it. If you feel like you've got to hide it, it's wrong. Ladies, the exact same thing. If you're hiding it, it is wrong. The same power is upon us. So this is what I want you to do. Next time you get ticked, next time you get mad, next time you get angry, next time pride arises in your life and somebody ticks you off, I want you to do this. And think about your action. Give God a second to get involved in your mouth. Give God a second to get involved in your attitude. Give God a second to do something incredible. Give God a moment. And you'll be amazed at what God does. What did he do? He let pride get the best of him, and he let anger get the best of him. Now, I'm going to take you to one last thought, and then I'm going to leave you alone. Judges chapter 15, what we've been looking at, he gets mad and he does all these dumb things. He's had, I would say, a long day. Picks up like the jawbone of a donkey, and he kills 1,000 men. How long does that take to kill 1,000 men with a jawbone of a donkey? Because after about the first 10, don't you know that they're running everywhere? So he is chasing them down and he's whooping. How long does it take to chase down 1,000 men who are running from you? So I don't know. In my opinion, I'm going, this was a long day. In Judges 15, 18, it says this. Because he was very thirsty. I bet he was thirsty. Probably hungry too. Probably tired. Because he was very thirsty, he cried out to the Lord. Don't you wish the story were written? He cried out to God the first time he got mad. He cried out to God the first time he looked at that Philistine woman. I lost her. Would it have been better for him to cry out to God then? Would it have been better for him to cry out before he stuck his hand into the dead lion's carcass? Would it be better before if he had cried out to God before he let that alcohol touch his lips? Would have been better if he had cried out to God before all these things happened that saw himself in a downward spiral that took him to a place he didn't want to go. It says, now he had become very thirsty and he cries out to God. Why is it that we have to be at the bottom of our emotional bucket before we cry out to God? Oh God, I've already done everything wrong. Now I will cry out to you. Isn't that how we do it? Now that I've screwed everything up, God, now I'm going to cry out to you. God, now that I've made a big mess of my life, now I'm going to trust you. Now I need you. Screwed everything up on my own. Don't see what I can do with you. So he cries out to the Lord, you have given your servant this great victory. Well, okay. Don't know if I don't know if God did that or not, but the power of God was on him. Must I now die of thirst and fall into the hands of these uncircumcised people? I mean, is this really want your man of God to die? I'm going to die of thirst out here. Isn't it funny how, do you think God ever gets mad at us for acting like this? I mean, he's been a big baby all the way through this thing, and now he's thirsty, and now I want God. How does God react to that? Then God opened up the hollow place in Leah, and water came out of it. Hey, he's just our provider. Does anybody grasp the reality of what is happening here? He has screwed up. He has screwed up. He has screwed up. He has screwed up. He has messed up. Innocent people have died. They have lost their life. He has made a mockery out of God. He's made a mockery out of his anointing. He's made a mockery out of his own strength that only comes from God. And now he's crying out to God. He's saying, God, must I die here? For God so loved the world that he gave. So much he loves us.
Come on.
He gave his everlasting life that we wouldn't have to die. Here's the bottom line. You can't screw up enough where God says, I'm done with you.
Right.
It doesn't matter what you did last night. It doesn't matter how bad you goofed up in your life. God's always there to pull us back out. And God opened up the hollow in this place, and water came out of it. And when Samson drank, his strength returned. You grasping this? His strength returned, and he was revived. Are you ready to be done with the pride? Are you ready to be done with the arrogance? Are you ready to be done with the anger that takes us over the wrong place? Are you ready to cry out to God and say, God, I am thirsty for more of you. God, I'm thirsty for your righteousness. God, I'm thirsty for your forgiveness. God, I'm thirsty to know that you're not rejecting me, but that you're receiving me. God, I am thirsty for you. And if you will cry out to God with that heart, with that compassion, with that spirit, God will open up a place. Water will pour. And when you take of that water, you're going to be strengthened and you're going to be revived. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
As you stand, as we go to the Lord in prayer today, how many of you just be honest and say, whoo, I didn't realize I had so much confidence in Samson. I mean, in reality, can you say that? I didn't know that I had so much in common. I mean, I've never gone out and caught 300 foxes and set them on fire and sent them to the village of Amarillo. But I have done some stupid things as sure as ruined my influence. But you may be here today saying, I do understand. I understand now. I want to do a simple prayer time. And I'm going to ask everybody just reverently to close their eyes just really quick. And I want you to just stick with me for just a second and don't look around, okay? Don't look around. I want this to be the most serious moment of the day. If you're in this place today, I believe that you were spirit-led to be here to hear this message. I think God had this just for you. God knows where we need to be. And if we're in this place, and you feel like, I can identify with Samson, and I feel like I'm a little lost. First of all, I want to ask this question. If you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you don't know him. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm really not. I want this to be so serious today. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to have you come down front. I'm not going to do that to you. But I'm just so, man, I don't know if convicted about this message is the right word, but I feel so strongly about this message that God is dealing with somebody's heart here today. If you come in this place today and you don't know Jesus, I want to pray with you before you leave. I just want to give you the opportunity to ask him into your life. And you don't have to move where you're at. You can stand right where you are. But if that's you being so serious and so hungry and so in need, saying, God, I just thirst after you. That's you. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand today, and I just want to pray with you. Just raise your hand real quick and put it right back down. I just want to pray with you. Okay, I see a hand. Is there somebody else? Oh, I feel so strong that the Lord is just tugging at somebody's heart today. I see it. Yeah, I see it. I see it. Anybody else? Our church believes in walking through the process with you. Because when you're never alone when you're with God. And you're never alone when you're in a church like this. So we're going to ask you to pray this prayer. I'm going to pray it. I want you to repeat it after me. But our church people is going to pray it with you so you're not alone. Because you'll never be alone ever again when you're in the family of God. So let's pray.
Dear Jesus,
I am a sinner.
I am a sinner.
And I realize That I do not know you.
That I do not know you.
And I am lost without you.
And I am lost without you.
Today.
Today.
I am thirsty.
I am thirsty.
And I ask you.
I ask you
to come into my life.
Come into my life.
I want you to be the Lord of my life.
I want you to be the Lord of my life.
Clean me up.
Clean me up.
Clean me out.
Clean me out.
And now fill me up.
With the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Amen.
And welcome home. Hey, we want to give you the opportunity to talk to someone after the service. And this is usually scary to somebody because people don't like to do this. But Ken is over here. Ken would love to talk with you. Just look for the guy in the cowboy sweatshirt that is anointed, by the way, t-shirt. But look for Ken after the service, and Ken's going to be here. He'd just like to talk to you for just a moment. Just a moment. Nothing threatening about this conversation at all. But he'd like to hand you something and pray with you. But before you leave, there may be some others in here who say, I'm right with God. But today I've had an attitude check. I'm right with God, but there are some things that need to go and some things that need to come into my life. One of them is pride, another is anger, but I want to be spirit-led in what I do. And if that's you, guess what? We're going to pray that tap from heaven will be open and that the water will pour out in the most incredible way. That when you partake it, you are going to be full and satisfied, that you're going to be strengthened and refreshed. And this is what's going to happen. This is my prayer, that this week is going to be the most refreshing week in your walk with God that you've ever had, because you've opened yourself up to let the Spirit of God do something in your life. Anybody want that prayer? I'm going to pray for you before you leave. Can you pray with me? I'm going to ask you to do something, okay? This is one of those weird things. I want you to surrender yourselves. It's a hand motion that says, I surrender myself. Okay? I'm going to receive it. I'm going to ask you, if you really want that, I want you to put your hands in an area of receiving, and it's an area of worship. Father, today I want more of your Spirit. Let my pride go away. Let my anger go away. And today I cry out because I am thirsty for something different and something new. Today let the arrogance go away. Let the pride go away. Father, let your Holy Spirit come in the most incredible way. Father, today I pray that guilt will leave as we give it to you. That unhappiness will leave as we give it to you. That selfishness will leave as we give it to you. That those things that hold us back and those things that hinder us to be all that you have called us to be. Father, today I surrender to you. Today I receive your very best. Come on, somebody, receive it. I receive it in the name of Jesus. Father, this is what I pray. As you're filling them, forgiving them, and working in them, I'm going to pray that you will put a joy inside their spirits like never before. Come on, I receive that joy. There is a peace that is going to come over my mind. There is a peace that's going to come over my spirit. Turmoil in the name of Jesus. You are gone. Pain, you are gone in the name of Jesus. Desert places are going to be filled and look like oceans. As we honor God, as we're being spirit-led, walking in forgiveness, and now there's a joy and a peace that passes all understanding. And I receive it. Come on, I receive it. It's going to be a good week. It's going to be a good week. God, I pray that as we leave this place today, that the power of God will go upon us in the most incredible way. And Father, I pray that as we leave this place today, that you will put a smile on our face and that you will put a skip in our step. And we're going to give you all the praise and the glory. Amen.
Amen. Amen.